Oh, alright, so, as of writing this, the new chapter for Make Your Mark will be released in about a month, so may I be rushing this a little bit? Maybe. Either way, I'm going to use the same clip as I used before, because there's another prominent feature in this clip that I must discuss. The weather. Yeah, dreaded topic, I know, but just hear me out here. As you've seen here in this clip, it's actually raining in Zephyr Heights, so there's going to most likely be something mentioned about the weather in this chapter. If not, then just one of these episodes. But the thing is, how the hell does that work now in G5? Well, let me inform some of the new fandom members here who don't understand the issue with this to begin with. You see, back in MLP,
friendship is magic.
Pegasi were the ones literally ruling the sky in a big city called Cloudsdale, helping with all sorts of weather for each season, day, and occasion. They literally have a weather factory that almost every Pegasi there works at. While we don't know how they first managed to control and help with the weather, not to my knowledge at least, we know that from the very beginning of the series that they were the ones to help with it, while Celestia and Luna controlled the sun and moon. The Pegasi are nowhere close to Alicorns, yet they have the ability to maintain weather, probably because there's more than one Pegasi doing all of the work. Here is where the issue comes in. In G5, the Pegasi could no longer fly until the magic was restored. So how did they get all of that weather stuff sorted out? And what the hell happened to Cloudsdale? Well, a common theory that I've heard about this is, it just fell. Like, not even just the Pegasi. The whole city itself must have came crashing down at some point. Everything there just broken, gone. The weather probably stopped working entirely, or at least the necessities for working were no longer available. They either ended up crashing down on the mountain they built themselves on now, or crashed somewhere nearby. This city does move, it is a large cloud after all, but once the magic poofed, the Pegasi could no longer hold their ground on clouds anymore. Hell, maybe the city didn't fall at all, maybe it was just them that fell and they figured out some way to still get up there and grab the Sphinx they needed to rebuild on land. I don't know, maybe the falling city thing is a lot more likely, but who knows. Whatever happened, it does lead me to believe that they rebuilt and expanded what is now known as Zephyr Heights. Could explain why it's so high-tech in advance. Maybe they still used to provide weather until the tribes fully split off, leaving the Pegasi with the weather duty, all by creating a large weather machine on ground instead of in the air. There's actually a bit of proof of this, officially, yet not officially. Let me explain. When I was scrolling through TikTok, I stumbled upon this unused scene in the New Generation movie. In this, it shows that they do indeed have a weather machine built, working like it would back in the sky in the old days, controlling all elements of weather for their city. Probably, mainly their city. So, what about the rest of Equestria? That seems to be the biggest and most important issue at Hoof. Maybe the Pegasi still had a weather thing going, but what about the other two locations? How did Maritime Bay and Bridalwood manage the weather? Well, in the snow situation, since it was the most explained in the series than any other weather at this point in time, it's said that it has not snowed once in Maritime Bay, presumably because it's more of a beach town and is used to being a hot weather area, like how Grandma Figgy explains in Winter Wish Day. For Zephyr Heights, it's not confirmed if it's ever snowed there before. I'm going to assume it has, and they most likely created the snow themselves, so they pretend it's normal for them, unlike the rest of Equestria. But in Bridalwood's case, it snowed before the magic disappeared. It seems that unicorns of ancient past made the snow appear using an ancient spell, which the unicorns accidentally cast in Winter Wish Day. I assume the event happened during the split up, but before any magic disappeared. Maybe when the unicorns realized they needed to make weather for themselves, they used either an already made spell or made up a spell themselves. I guess the spell that the unicorns of this generation cast was so much, it expanded itself onto the other two locations. And you know, because of that, Zephyr Heights didn't need to use their weather machine because they saw the snow and like, oh, is the weather machine going? No? I guess we don't need it. As for any other kind of weather, Right now, it's still unsure. Maybe it still rains in Bridalwood and Maritime Bay. Maybe it works automatically in the sense of how the sun and moon could be right now. Or maybe it just never really rained at all, and just the sun and moon was all that there was. Occasionally, there are some clouds that come overhead, but no rain. For Maritime Bay, if they needed a water source, presumably they could just go to the ocean that's right next to them. Doesn't seem like they get a whole lot of wind despite there being clouds. As for Sefer Heights, it's obvious that the Pegasi do have some sort of weather machine in their city. At least I hope. Like, seriously, I hope they confirm that in the series. I need to see it. As for Bridalwood, it could be the same thing for them in terms of Maritime Bay situation, relying on the forest of Bridalwood instead to take care of their needs. Maybe before the magic disappeared, they did learn how to control weather on their own, just like they did with the snow. And when the magic disappeared, they probably relied on creeks or rivers, anything in the forest that could be of a water source, or just anything generally natural in that area. The crystals here, however, seem to hold a magic of their own, so maybe they played a part in this as well. Now, with the sun and moon. It's a little tricky, but easier to answer. The sun and moon are also kind of a part of the weather and also important environmental necessities, so I'm gonna add them on top of this too. Back in the final season of MLP Friendship is Magic, the sisters gave an amulet to Twilight with a bit of their magic to control the sun and moon while they go on a trip. Self-explanatory. It most likely seemed that she has kept that amulet long after the sisters finally retired, and Twilight set an automatic spell to have them raise and set on their own. Or maybe before the sisters retired, they made that amulet into something stronger to keep the sun and moon rising themselves, so then Twilight didn't have to worry about it, upgrading some of the technology in the process. Oh my god, another upload?! Alright, okay, so I'm still keeping my theory about the sun and moon, like I said above, nothing's gonna change there. Let's just talk a little about this video of Tell Your Tale and what's going on with the moon. In this episode, the Pegasi in Sefer Heights celebrate a moon festival every 10 years with when the moon gets closer to the Earth. A certain part of Equestria, really. Which is a very neat tradition, to be frank, but now with the magic being back, whatever is illuminating off of the moon is making the magic stronger. Overcharging it, actually. Yeah. So my explanation before still stands, it's just, is that automatic magic causing things to go haywire? Whatever magic Twilight and or the sisters, or just Twilight, has casted onto the sun and moon is somehow affecting the pony's magic, but why? Maybe because it's been so long since any pony has had magic that there was no balance to hold the automated magic spell for the sun and moon to work, overpowering itself? But like, only works if it's close enough to the earth? What? This is, okay. This is a little tricky. Maybe it's something completely different and just something happened over time with the moon. We haven't experienced it with the sun yet, except for the overbearing heat, but that's just normal. That's normal in everyday life. Just what's going on with the moon? I'm not gonna get any further into it right now, because, like, who knows? Like, this could just be a one-off written episode that is never spoken about again, and maybe something different will end up occurring in the main series, or maybe it will come out more consistently in, I don't know, the sixth chapter. Yeah, I know. Sorry, Starlight fans, I really do not think this chapter is going to be about your favorite poem. I'm sorry, y'all can go home. If I end up being wrong, you can come after me all you want. Guaranteed. Anyways, sadly, this is where my speculations end. I'm not sure what else to bring up other than these theories and points, since again, this series is just beginning, despite the amount of episodes Tell Your Tales bringing out, and we don't have a lot to go off of yet. So I hope that these theories and summaries can help solve at least some of this. Maybe in the new chapter, some of these answers will come into light. If not, then this is all we have for now. Thank you for watching, despite all of this weird, quote-unquote, lore-breaking nonsense is going on, I hope you're still just as hyped for the new chapter as I am. If not, then...
Okay, cool, I don't know.
Anyway, I'll see you on the next video, sub for more, and, you know, if you like this, ring the bell, too, and whatnot, share with your friends, let me know what you think in the comments, and, you know, typical YouTube stuff.
I'm sorry if I don't sound too good with my wording in this one, I had a lot of work to do, before I got recording, so, right now, I'm weak, so, and, you know, my quality of my mic is complete shit, so, I'm glad that y'all are bearing with me even after all this time. Really appreciate it. Thank you for almost 300 subs. We're less than halfway there. Sort of less than halfway there. Really appreciate you guys. I'll see you in the next one. Cheers.